What is going on, my darling listeners? This is Christian Anarchy, and I am Jeremiah, changing the world one podcast episode at a time. Some people provide clean water to those who have none. Some people make a lot of money and give it away to people in need. Martin Luther King held protests for civil rights where he was beaten and eventually killed for standing up for the oppressed. Mother Teresa stayed with and cared for and talked to and befriended the lepers as they were dying. Some people build homeless shelters. Jesus did miracles of healing and resurrection from the dead and eventually was killed, dying to forgive the whole world. And I put my thoughts on an audio recording and place them on the internet. It's such an honor to even be mentioned, even by myself, in the same sentence as that group. We begin with concluding remarks. Break up the pieces and examine the parts. Your words always cut when they're cliche. But here's my knife because I came for the buffet. This is the way it goes when you are part of it. Nervously saying words, little surprising bed. A mark beneath the chin. I caught you once again. Hey y'all, welcome to the show. In case you're looking for an update, this has been a very disheartening week. As some of you know, I cut my hand last week on the day of the podcast recording. It is exactly a week later, and my finger has been swollen all week. My hand is still in pain. I have been unable to sleep more than an hour at a time most nights, and feel like I've barely slept all week. And I've been functioning one-handed for the last 7 days because my hand is in so much pain, my fingers are so swollen, I can't really use them effectively at all whatsoever. So if I happen to sound a little depressed today, that's why. There is a good chance I won't sound depressed, though, as I generally try not to be too expressive for fear I will deceive someone into thinking that it will be interesting to listen to me. Also, I often don't like it when people know whether or not I'm joking. It's my own little game, and I find the most monotone expression helps to hide that from them. So I tend to talk in monotone because on one hand I don't want to deceive, and on the other hand I do. Anyway, if you want to contact me, my email address is jeremiahjm@gmail.com, and you can find all sorts of fantastic stuff. I admit fantastic is overselling it a little bit, but you can find some mediocre stuff at www.christianarchy.net. Today's episode is going to be a little weird, as opposed to most podcasts about Christian anarchy, which are totally normal, containing nothing out of the ordinary. So I had the naive thought a couple of years ago, maybe a year ago, that everyone would be kind of similar to myself, where ethical arguments for anarchy would suffice to make people anarchists. My story is that in 2012, I was exposed to a guy named Ron Paul, who was technically a Republican, but very much a libertarian who happens to run in the Republican Party, and someone who, while he was running, even recommended many anarchist economists and other anarchist authors. Ron Paul exposed me to the non-aggression principle, which is that it is wrong to initiate force on other people or their property through physical violence, theft, or fraud. So I began to apply that to government and run into others who applied that to government. I didn't apply it consistently. I ended up being one of those people that thought there is a minimum necessary amount of government for a society to function. But over time, I realized that even this minimum necessary government that was in my idealized world was still aggression. It was still violence on peaceful people. So outside of any authors, even, and outside of other thinkers who were anarchists, I began thinking about ways to eliminate or minimize this, like maybe you put government in the smallest possible region where all governments or most government actions were taken care of at just a city level, so that if someone didn't like the government in one area, they could just move to a different city and get a completely different government. But still, for the people who already lived in that city, it's aggression against them. Any government functioning like a normal government would be aggressing against them in order to impose their will on them. And just because they could move to a different city didn't justify the government's use and threat of violence on them. So even though that idea was preferable because I think it would have led to less violence on peaceful people, it was still unacceptable ethically. So I started thinking of things like maybe you could fund government privately, where you just had a really small government that was only funded through donations and not taxation, or where taxation was actually voluntary. But there would still be a monopoly which prevented competitors if you had a government at all. And a voluntarily funded government which prevented other people from competing with their services would still be violating the rights of those people who wanted to compete and any potential customers who would rather hire a private organization. Once I exhausted in my head the ways I was trying to figure out how to justify the existence of government or how to imagine a government that was just, or to imagine how you might change government in order to make it an organization which treated people ethically, I think it was days after that before I was finally like, yeah, I guess I'm an anarchist now. One day I was having a conversation about government, and I found myself arguing that private security would be at least as effective or more effective at defending people and their property as the government monopoly on police were. And I think it was at that point when I realized I had made the turn completely from someone who supported the minimum state to someone who supported no state at all. But it wasn't the pragmatic arguments that brought me to that place. It was the ethical ones. And I didn't have to deal much with scripture at this point to make the transition from minarchist, which is someone who supports minimal government, to an anarchist. I was already comfortable with the idea that there wasn't a specific type of government the Bible promoted, and I didn't feel obligated to support any particular form. I also, like anyone, had to deal with Romans 13 to understand those verses in light of the other scriptures, which talk about how evil most governments are, their corrupting influence, and how Jesus and many of his followers were killed by political rulers. Anyone who takes all of scripture seriously, even someone with no political views or someone who loves government, has to do something to understand statements from Romans 13 like, rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad. Because time after time, in both biblical and extra-biblical stories, we have nearly infinite evidence to the contrary, which show that, if anything, it often seems rulers do more to terrorize good people than the evil ones. So I already had to understand Romans 13 as explaining how God wanted to use governments and how he was working to use them, and understand that the rulers weren't choosing to be very cooperative. So I already lacked the biblical barriers to becoming an anarchist. And after being exposed to the idea that I should apply the basic ethics I used in my everyday life to the government, it was, given my personality, inevitable that I would eventually reject the violence of the state. I don't do well with inconsistencies, especially ethical ones. Because I could not support something I believed was immoral, I blindly jumped into anarchy. I just thought, well, it's pretty obvious. The government requires the dehumanization of others. I won't do that. So I guess we have to figure out better ways to organize society. And then that was it. It was clear to me theft and threatening people with death for not submitting to your will was evil. And it was clear to me the government owed its very existence to these things. So even without clear answers to many of my questions about a world without government, what choice did I have? It was either cling to an evil system or be okay with unsurety about what I would do without the evil system. For me, this became no choice at all. Government was evil, and I couldn't live with myself and support evil. I have a hard enough time living with myself as it is. Other people are not like me. I'm sure that is very good in many ways, and bad in other ways. I'm not sure which one this is, or if it's either of them. It might be neutral, and it just is. But even many people who do care about acting ethically toward their fellow man have a harder time making the transition than I did. The questions they have are rarely ethical and are sometimes biblical, but are almost always focused around practical concerns. This has been somewhat surprising for me. It's not surprising people have these practical questions, but it is surprising that they are such a barrier. From most, I expected more biblical and ethical arguments than pragmatic ones. I know that this is redundant because I've said it so many times, but I've yet to meet someone who, when it was explained to them and they understood how government existed through violent aggression against peaceful people, I've yet to meet someone who argued the opposite of that, that the government doesn't exist through such violent aggression. Of the hundreds of conversations I've had, no one has ever disagreed with this central assertion. Instead, most try to justify the violent aggression of the state using absurd ideas like the state owns all the land, or the land surrounding people's property, or has implicit consent from citizens, or the citizens can leave so it's fine, or their aggression is necessary. They make all sorts of justifications that they would never be okay with or find convincing if I turned around and used one of their justifications and applied it to some other form of violent aggression, like rape. In fact, they would be appalled I would ever even try to justify such an obviously violent violation of the self-ownership of another person. And rightfully so. But they should be equally appalled by their own justification of government's exercising of ownership over the individual. Anyway, it doesn't matter. The truth is, my ethical and biblical arguments have not been as persuasive in terms of getting people on board the anarchy train as I'd hoped. Maybe it's because my arguments aren't as well expressed or as convincing as I thought. Or maybe it's that people require more extensive dealing with the potential practical problems and their solutions than I anticipated. Or maybe I'm wrong about that too, and people just need more time with some of the ideas I presented for them to sink in and affect their worldview at a more fundamental level. I don't know. And I have dealt with some of the major practical issues that people wonder about, and I've been pretty general with various things, with a few specific examples I thought would be particularly difficult to imagine solutions for. And while at the time people listening to them thought they were convincing or thought they were potentially workable, and many have said as much and said that the ideas I presented were very helpful and made sense when they were thinking about a world without government, this, for most, only seemed to be effective for a few days. And after that, the same questions that they had that I thought I proposed a decent answer to, maybe I did, maybe I didn't, but the same questions often burned in them, and they still wondered and worried about them. I suspect for a lot of these things that reading and the written word are superior to the audio format, as it's often much easier to remember that for most people. You can go back easier, you can pause and reread and refocus on things that they said to figure out if they make sense. Whereas when I'm talking, it's much harder to pause and go back 30 seconds and hear if what I said made sense. And when reading, you can always look at it again, underline it, analyze the concepts. And it's so easy to just bookmark a spot in a reading and share it with someone or think about it than it is when you have someone talking in your head for 40 minutes. I think many people are unintentionally looking for a magical, flawless solution to all the problems of the world, which is 100% convincing to every party involved. They want absolute surety about certain things in an anarchist society in order to ease their fears. But I don't have that. I don't have a magical solution that will 100% happen or even 50% happen. There are only a lot of potentialities. No one has the magic pill to ease all of anyone's fears. We cannot predict the future. We can only surmise about it and talk about what's existed in the past or exists presently elsewhere and talk about how we might improve upon the current system in various ways in a free society, but we will never be able to talk about what will for sure happen in a free society until after we get there. And people don't like the hypothetical nature of things. It scares them. It's not concrete. Not like the government is now, where at least you can see it. It seems to me that a single system which is bad in reality often sounds better to people than 10 systems which are good in theory. At least one can see government courts. At least you can drive around and look at the police station and the fire department, and you have images of and an awareness of a massive military that is theoretically out there protecting you and your freedom from the evil terrorists. They're very visible and immediate and easy to understand. And even kind of silly things like roads are easier to imagine happening under government than in a free society because we can see them happening under government. All these things which actually exist, even though their existence is unethical, feel more attractive than the presentation of ethical alternatives which do not exist. As a result, people cling to what they know due to their fear of the unknown. The devil they know is better than the devil they don't. At least we know how to function in this world, know what to expect and can survive. That feels comforting, even if it is far, far from perfect. I think this is why many slaves, when freed, even slaves that were freed in the U.S., said they were satisfied with their slavery and would rather not have been freed from being subjugated to their masters. The devil they knew was better than the freedom they did not know what to do with. With all that being said, perhaps surprisingly, I will no longer do as much to address the practical questions of a world without government. Not because answers aren't available, or I cannot come up with something plausible, but because I'm often not that interested in discussing these solutions. And more importantly, there are many people who have spent decades of their life thinking about and providing answers to these questions, which are usually far better than what I can come up with in a week before the next podcast. So don't expect too much more explanation of practical solutions unless I really want to do one, or I believe they are directly related to scripture or the Christian anarchist perspective. But if they're more general pragmatic solutions, which aren't necessarily inherently in conjunction with the Bible, what I'm going to do instead is make a small list of some of the most common concerns about a free society and provide multiple links to books, videos, articles, and podcasts to help answer those questions. The few which come to mind immediately are things like national defense, security of persons and property, law, courts, and caring for the poor. When I deal with these issues, I sometimes feel like I may be doing a disservice both to you and to the many others who have gone before me who have dealt with these issues better than I can at this point, or more thoroughly than I can at least. While I believe I often have a unique and valuable voice to add to these discussions, it would be arrogant of me to only share with you my thoughts without directing you toward other people, especially those who are much more familiar with history and economics and past justice systems and stuff like that. It's probably a better use of my time to focus more on areas where I have unique things to add to the movement. And I'm not sure if I am at a place yet where I really have a unique perspective to add to most of the practical problems people bring up. Having said all that, I do want to talk a little bit today about pragmatic concerns in a more general fashion. It continues to surprise me how often when I make a biblical or ethical argument for anarchy, within 2 minutes, people express a variety of concerns which have nothing to do with whether government is ethical. People wonder about how the region they live in will be defended from invaders, how their property will be defended from robbers, their body from murderers, what we will do about the justice system, and what about provision of these services to the poor. Try suggesting anarchism to people and see what happens. Very often they will bring up one or all of these questions. Given the propensity for people to bring things like these up, what can we learn? What does this tell us? It tells us that the vast majority of people want these things. And this means that there will be a very large market for protection of people and their property, for a justice system, and for the provision of these services to everyone, not just the upper middle class and above. Because there are so many of us who are very concerned about justice for the poor and the oppressed. Because there will be a market for these things, because we already know everyone wants these things, it means companies will be competing to keep their customers and their property more safe and secure and for the cheapest price possible. It means multiple systems of justice and arbitration and dispute resolution will form to meet the needs and desires of people in a society, and due to the natural improvements which always seem to come from free market competition, these systems will become increasingly just over time. It means companies and charities and individuals will come up with all sorts of ways of providing these things for the few who cannot afford them. So if you're concerned about these things, don't worry, you're not alone. I'm concerned too. Everyone I know is. The sheer number of people who want to have these products and services should at least assure you that they will not be absent in a free society. The services the government provides, whose absence most people are concerned about, are precisely the services we would expect to be present in a free society. One thing most people intuit is that monopolies don't provide very good products or services. This is usually true. It's quite funny, actually. One fear people have about anarchy, or at least one argument people have against anarchy, is that without government, there wouldn't be companies who form monopolies. If this happens to be your concern, an honest response is that it is conceivable that there will be monopolies without the government preventing them. But if these monopolies form because they provide the best products and services to consumers at such a good price, no one else can compete with them, it's not really that big of a problem. But it's very, very unlikely that one company will be able to do that. And I don't conceive of a natural monopoly being present in a free society at all, because it will be so easy without government intervention to compete with those companies. But what I wanted to point out about this very concern about there being monopolies without government is that the government is one giant coercive monopoly. Coercive monopolies are way worse than natural monopolies. If natural monopolies are bad, coercive monopolies are terrifying. In the case of a natural monopoly, you can always have someone come up to compete, then there's no longer a monopoly. In the case of a violent or coercive monopoly like the government has, they force every customer to do business with them, and they prevent any other potential competitors from arising to challenge their monopoly. So you don't have any sort of substantive accountability through competition. I mean, imagine if any company had a monopoly on a city or on a state or on the entire United States like the government does. Whether that was a home builder or a cell phone company or a cable company, we would expect their service to be poor and to be very costly. There's no reason to suppose, as many do, that monopolies are bad for every product and service out there, except the products and services that the government provides. We should assume that the same rules that we think would apply to anyone who had a monopoly on services, especially a coercive one, also apply to government's monopoly on services, where these services are nowhere near as they would be if there were competition, if there were competing service providers for similar products that the customers could decide between. One conceivable argument supporting the idea that the government is better than a natural monopoly is that it's held accountable through voting. While I won't argue that voting does absolutely nothing to hold the government accountable, I will argue that it does next to nothing. Its ineffectiveness is obvious to anyone paying attention, to anyone who sees that it is the lobbyists and the politicians and the powerful who get their way in the government, not the average voter. The average voter cannot even find a candidate they want to vote for. They can only find the lesser of two evils. The average voter holds the government accountable by electing someone into office they willingly say is evil, just less evil than the other guy. Electing a bunch of evil people, even lesser evil people, will not lead to government accountability. That wouldn't make any sense. To further illustrate this idea that voting doesn't really hold coercive monopolies accountable, I'm going to ask you to use your imagination. Imagine McDonald's has a coercive monopoly on food, and they function like a government. They force everyone to pay for their food, and they provide their food to the whole world, and they have different pay structures for different people of different incomes to purchase their food, and they claim the sole right to be the providers of this food, and they won't let people compete with them. So they have this coercive monopoly, just like government has, and like the government, they let people vote for a couple of people who have the chance to become managers, and every 4 years you can vote for one of two people who has the chance to become a CEO of the company. And maybe these people will make changes to McDonald's to improve its service and limit its cost. Maybe they won't. Maybe the other manager will get elected, the one you didn't vote for, and make it worse. Or maybe your manager will get elected and make it worse. You don't know. The only tool you have in your belt to hold McDonald's accountable and to get them to provide the food and service you want at the price you want is a vote every couple of years. Do you think McDonald's will be held accountable by the democratic election of CEO and managers? Do you think that you will get the type of food and services and efficiency at the cost you're looking for if McDonald's had a coercive monopoly on food? Please say no. Or say yes, but say it sarcastically. Of course, the accountability of voting will be very weak. Even with the chance for its customers to vote, McDonald's will provide poor service at a high cost. No amount of voting would be able to hold McDonald's as accountable as even one Hardee's would. If consumers had merely one other choice and could choose to either pay Hardee's for food or McDonald's for food, the two companies would have to compete for customers, prices would drop, quality would go up. Just one competing company would make a huge difference. But as we know, if you took away McDonald's coercive monopoly on food, there wouldn't just be Hardee's. There would be hundreds of fast food restaurants. There would be tens of thousands of other restaurants. There would be grocery stores all over the place. People could even cook their own food or even grow their own food. The possibilities would be nearly endless, and the quality of the food products relative to their cost would be very impressive and almost unbelievable and unfathomable when compared to the quality and the cost of the food when there was only one company allowed to provide it, and when everyone had to pay for that company's provision of food. When a coercive monopoly provides products and services, whether said monopoly is a government or McDonald's, even if they give their customers a vote, we should expect them to provide substantially worse products at substantially higher costs than would be provided in a free market for those products. Right now, the government has a coercive monopoly on really important services for humanity, like law, security, and justice. People may not realize it, but they are living in a world where these services are as bad as we would expect food to be from a McDonald's with zero competition. Free the markets, improve the services. As long as we've developed this metaphor, I'm going to play with it a little bit, I think. If this was always the reality of the world, or it had been for generations, the McDonald's having a coercive monopoly on food, then it shouldn't be hard to imagine if someone in this imaginary world talked about removing McDonald's monopoly being criticized by others. If people only knew of McDonald's as the way to acquire food, they would not want their source of food removed, and they would have trouble imagining any other way. They might say things like, "But without McDonald's, how will we eat? Who will provide the food? You think you can pay for a whole restaurant to exist by yourself? How can the poor afford to eat without everyone being forced to pay for everyone else's food? You just want the rich to get richer by exploiting the poor's need for food. You're a naive child if you think we can survive without food. We need food, and therefore everyone should be forced to pay for McDonald's for the good of society." All of these arguments sound absurd now because we know people don't need to be forced to pay for something like food in order to be willing to pay for something like food. And we know if only McDonald's existed, our food quality would not be very good, and it would not lead to the best outcomes for humanity. However, in this imaginary context, I do think these arguments would sound convincing because people didn't know or experience a different world where their food came from multiple sources. I think they would sound convincing because, to many, they do sound convincing when it comes to many of the services government provides now. People make unfounded assumptions like if there was no government, then people wouldn't be willing to pay for courts and private arbitrators to seek justice. Or if there was no government, people wouldn't be willing to pay to have their neighborhoods kept safe, or their region safe. Or if there was no government, there would be no laws. Or with no government, the poor would all be wiped out due to starvation and people taking advantage of them. All of these are unfounded assumptions coming from the worldview of those who have no other reality. These are the same type of assumptions people would make if the only reality they knew was that McDonald's is the sole provider of food for them and their loved ones. I say all this to make two simple points. One, if there are a lot of people concerned about having or not having a particular service the government provides now, there will be a market for those services. And two, if there is a free market for those services, we should expect them to provide better services at lower costs of increasing efficiency, which improve based upon the market pressures for those services. And those service providers, unlike government, can be held almost immediately accountable for their actions, not just through appeals to courts that those service providers don't run, unlike the government, which is only held accountable through its own courts that it runs, which makes absolutely no sense whatsoever. Done like that, those service providers can be held accountable immediately through courts and immediately by choosing where you want to spend your money. Whereas with the government, if they are being unjust, you still have to pay for their injustice or you'll be killed. I think all that makes some sense, and I hope, thinking just about those two concepts generally, that if a lot of people want it, there's a market for it, and monopolies provide worse services than companies that have competition, will help you be somewhat assured that the things you are most concerned about lacking with the abolition of the state will not be absent with the abolition of the state. They will just look different. And now another random thing that is a bit of a non sequitur. I've been thinking about this podcast in general lately and what I should do with it. Compared to most things I've done, whether that be blogging or social media presence or things like that, online things, I guess, even just my real life friend group, the podcast has reached a far wider audience with a lot more information. So I've at least been somewhat influential and hopefully provided many people with interesting content and some Christians with interpretations of scripture that they've never heard before, as well as providing an analysis of government that I don't think a lot of people have considered at any point in their lives or even been presented with at any point. However, despite this success, despite my satisfaction with this and having it be something that's been good for a lot of people, I believe, I have been thinking about an end date to this thing. At first, when I first started, I thought I would get to like 25 episodes. I didn't know I would even have more than that to say. And then I thought, after 10, I thought maybe 30. And here we are at 35. And I was considering going to 50 and quitting after exactly a year, which I may yet do, or I may go to 60. But I may also choose to end this thing at like 40 or 45-ish. I'm considering ending it not because I don't have more things to say or more things to make up, but because I do feel like at least I've laid a strong foundation from which people can move to other things which will help them build on that foundation. Maybe that's arrogant. I feel like the foundation is the gospel of Jesus. But in terms of this anarchist perspective, I've at least provided a substantial amount of thought and ethics and practical solutions and biblical arguments for anarchy and refutations of biblical arguments against anarchy. And that seems like enough to me. It seems like at least I have largely met my goal for this podcast, even though I haven't yet exhausted the topic of Christian anarchy, and I do have more things I still want to say. I really value you people for listening. I've enjoyed a lot about the process. I've learned a bunch of new skills, like sound editing and figuring out even what a burp and a cough look like. I learned how microphones work, what gain is. I still haven't yet learned how to breathe with a microphone in your face, or how best to speak in order to be able to be heard and keep a consistent volume. I even have a hard time keeping my mouth equidistant from the microphone, and I still do hand motions even though I'm talking alone in a closet. But still, according to most, and even most people who have heard me in church where I do sermons on a monthly basis, have said I've become a noticeably better speaker, which is helpful because, generally speaking, over the course of my life, I never actually expected to be good at such things because I've never enjoyed monologuing and I've never been able to do it well. And I've always had a lisp with sometimes I would talk too fast and sometimes I'd talk too slow and sometimes there'd be long pauses. And I'd mutter, change the volume of my speak. But I think I am getting generally better at speaking alone for long periods of time. But also, as I get better, I go off on more rabbit trails, which is interesting to me, but I have no idea what you guys think about those. They are very disorganized. Anyway, as far as this Christian anarchy stuff goes, after I do finally close up this podcast, I will continue to do some related things as it pertains to anarchy. I think I will write a book on the topic of Christian anarchy, as I planned to originally, dealing primarily with the text and its interpretations and my explanations of it. I feel like getting into practical issues when it comes to a book would just be too much. I may start writing some blog posts / articles for some friends' websites. And I'm considering starting another podcast down the road, which would primarily be a dialogue with either another person or a few people, or an interview-style podcast where I interview different anarchists about different topics. For those who have only heard me on this podcast, I assure you I can be an entertaining dialoguer as well. I'm actually much more entertaining as a dialoguer. I even say funny things. although I'm much more prone to saying mean things in order to make a joke. So if you do end up listening to that, be aware that I am not that nice of a guy. That I am periodically, accidentally a very mean person. Sometimes deliberately, but that's much more rare. But in my life, and in what I do and create, I will continue to work on this topic or think about this topic and tell people about this topic because I still believe that one of the next great areas in the human rights movement is humans as compared to their rulers. I think that anarchy is one of the next big steps in bringing the world from point C to point D in terms of being ethical toward one another. And I think I am one of the many thousands of people, hopefully hundreds of thousands and millions of people, that God has called to be a part of starting and throwing logs on the fire of this movement of humanity to treat each other with more dignity and respect. I also have a Bible study that I want to work on and publish somewhere, probably just for free online, but it's still publishing. I haven't finished. I just want to edit it and go back through everything, correcting my multitudinous grammar mistakes and reworking some of the questions. And that has really nothing to do with anarchy whatsoever. It's just something that I did that I think is really good and worthwhile for people to go through. Though, as I've said before, I would think that things that I do are really good and worthwhile for people to go through. But other people have said it's the best Bible study they've ever read. So that's something. I don't know. Anyway, I have other stuff I want to work on as well that are limited by me doing this podcast every week. I don't know if it's really a good idea for me to tell you guys that I'm planning on ending the podcast sometime within the next 10 to 15 episodes or something like that, because it might cause you not to listen. But I feel like I should be upfront with you guys about what I'm thinking, because you have been so awesome in listening periodically or every week or whenever your listening schedule is. Whatever it is, really appreciate it. And for now, I do have some interesting stuff coming up in no particular order. I'll be talking a little bit about abortion in general and how we might deal with abortion in a free society. I was actually recently on a kind of abortion panel hosted by the pastor of the church I attend just to try to get people discussing things they disagree with each other about in a manner that is kind and open and to show that we're able to both disagree and be respectful of one another, which I can do sometimes, and sometimes I disagree in a disrespectful way, much to my own shame. Anyway, so I was a panel member. We talked a little bit about abortion. I did a 10-minute segment, and I talked, actually, I'm not going to tell you what I talked about. I'm going to do a whole podcast episode on it, and I'll let you know then. And then I'm going to have a general conversation, one-sided as always, about how God uses human systems to bring justice in the world. And I wanted to talk about how he may also want to use systems Jesus followers are involved in to bring justice. What we see in scripture over and over again is God using evil systems to bring good into the world. But I think God can also use good systems to bring good into the world, even if those good systems might sometimes use force on other people, who use force on aggressors to prevent them from doing evil or to bring their victims to justice. And piggybacking on that general conversation, I'm going to do a different episode on a justice system in a free society and talk a little bit about Israel and their system of law and stuff like that. So that's some stuff coming up, which will be interesting for sure. So even though this podcast has a potential end date, you can listen in the future and enjoy and learn something or not learn something and think I'm wrong and then tell me why and then I'll respond to you because I cannot hold back myself to prevent a response. All right, guys, I'm starving. I have pizza waiting for me and I just got some Vicodin today and I've never tried a painkiller like that, so maybe I can sleep tonight. I'm out. Peace. Love you. Thanks for listening. Bye.